thank you for the invitation. Does it work? So before presenting open access policies in Horizon 2020, I will briefly introduce open access and open science. So what is open access? Open access means online access at no charge to the user, to peer-reviewed scientific publication and also to research data. And this online access also open access means also reuse and not only access to the data and to the publication. So why open access now? The main idea of the aim of open access is to optimize the impact of publicly funded research. The Europe strategy for a smart, sustainable and inclusive economy underlines the central role of knowledge and innovation in generating growth. Fuller and wider access to scientific publications and data therefore help to build and produce research results, foster collaboration and avoid duplication of effort, accelerate innovation and finally involve citizens and society. So in a few words, the expected benefits of open science are open access is good for science, for the economy, and also for society. Open access is integrated into a broader context, which is open science. Indeed, the transition towards a data-driven economy relies partly on the move towards open science. Open science is the global process of transformation and opening up science and research through ICT. The expected impact of open science are to make science more efficient, transparent, interdisciplinary, and also to enable broader societal impact and innovation. Among very prominent parts of open science, we find open access, assay, citizen engagement, e-infrastructure, research assessment, and also metrics. Now, our commissioner's view. So, Commissioner Oettinger, who is a commissioner for digital economy and society, and Commissioner Moedas, who is the one for research, science and innovation, stated together in June this year that open science is about making sure that science serves innovation and growth. It guarantees open access to publicly funded research results and the possibility of knowledge sharing. Open science is definitely a priority of Commissioner Moedas. We say he has three O's: open innovation, open science, and open to the world. Now, let's talk about open access policies in Horizon 2020, and let's begin by open access to publication. So what open access is now? Oh, it works now. My fault. So open access is not an obligation to publish. It's not at odds with patenting. You can see in the graph here. And it doesn't mean that the open access publication is of a lower quality. The peer review process is the same. So in this mandate, each beneficiary must ensure open access to all peer-reviewed scientific publications relating to its results. So the beneficiary must deposit a machine-readable copy of the published version of final peer-review manuscript accepted for publication in a repository of the researcher's choice and possibly OpenAI compliant. Secondly, the beneficiary must ensure open access on publication or at the latest within 6 or 12 months. This is called an embargo period. The beneficiary has also to ensure open access to the bibliographic metadata that identify the deposited publication via the repository. The aim is also to deposit at the same time the research data needed to validate the result. They are called underlying data. So, there are two routes towards open access to publication. So the routes are the following. We have the gold open access and the green open access. Under the green open access, which is a so-called self-archiving, the beneficiaries have to deposit their published article or their final peer-reviewed manuscript in an online repository before, alongside, or after its publication. In this case, they must ensure open access to the publication within an embargo period during which publishers sell subscription. Under the GOLD model, which is also referred as open access publishing, beneficiaries can publish immediately in open access journals. In this model, the payment of publication cost is shifted away from readers paying via subscription. The business model most often encountered is based on article processing charges, LPCs. Just, I didn't mention in my slide, but for your information, the European Commission organized in October of this year a workshop on alternative publishing models. Indeed, new and alternative open access publishing models are now emerging that would optimize existing arrangements and put forward new ones. The outcomes of the workshop are made available online, and the final report with a synthesis of all these emerging and already existing models is still in drafting. So, about licensing. So, the Commission encourages authors to retain their copyright and grant adequate licenses to publishers with, for example, Creative Commons licenses. Concerning the cost for OA publishing, so these costs are eligible during the grant, as is FP7. There is also a pilot for FP7 post-grant open access publishing. A few words on it. So, the European Commission has launched a pilot to fund open access publication for finalized FP7 project through the Open Air project. This 24-month pilot is being developed in the context of the Open Air 2020 project. It's a mechanism to support gold open access after end of grants. This pilot provides an additional instrument to make FP7 project research results open access. The pilot covers open access article processing charges for FP7 project up to 2 years after the end. A maximum of 3 peer-reviewed publications per project will be funded. Publication should be deposited into an open-air compliant repository. Open access monographs are eligible for the pilot. A budget of 4 million euros are being provided to support the pilot. A maximum of 2,000 euros per publication is provided for covering the fees. It's also important to note that the funding only applies to fully open access journal titles. This means that publication in hybrid journals are not supported by the pilot. The pilot started its operation on June 1st of this year, so it's therefore too early for a statistically significant analysis. And recently, a letter has been sent to the eligible project to inform them of the pilot. So we are waiting for the request, in a few words. Now, let's talk about open access to research data. So this pilot is a novelty in Horizon 2020. It aims to improve and maximize access to and reuse of research data generated by projects. The key questions are the following.
which thematic areas are covered, which, what data is covered, what are the requirements, and what about data management. So, first of all, the areas. So, in the latest work program participating, the area participating in the Open Research Data Pilot are the following. There are two pages on it. So, future and emerging technology, research infrastructure, leadership in energy and industrial technology, ICT, nanotechnology, advanced materials, advanced manufacturing and processing, biotechnology, societal challenges, security, sustainable agriculture and forestry, marine and maritime and inland water research and the bioeconomy, and also climate action, environment, resource efficiency and raw materials, Europe in a changing world, inclusive, innovative and reflective societies, and also science with and for society and cross-cutting activities. Project in other areas, which mean areas that are not covered by the scope of the pilot, are encouraged to participate in the pilot on a voluntary basis. Project may opt out of the pilot on open research data in Horizon 2020 in a series of cases at the submission stage. First, if the project will not generate or collect any data, can opt out. Second reason, if there is a conflict with the obligation to protect results. In other words, if the results can reasonably be expected to be commercially or industrially exploited. Another reason is confidentiality, another one is security, another one the rules concerning protection of personal data, and finally is the achievement of the action's main objective will be jeopardized by making specific parts of the research data openly accessible. This has to be explained in the data management plan. It has to be noted that the participation in the pilot is not part of the project evaluation. This means that proposals will not be evaluated more favorably because they are part of the pilot and will not be penalized for opting out of the pilot. Another important thing is that opting out during the project is also possible. We will need a contract amendment for this and an explanation in the data management plan. First important thing, being in the pilot does not mean opening all data. The focus of the pilot is on encouraging good data management as an essential element of research best practice. The pilot applies to two types of data. First, the data needed to validate the results presented in scientific publication, the underlying data. It also applies to other data as specified in the data management plan. Beneficiaries participating in the pilot will deposit this data in a research data repository of their choice, and also they will take measures to make it possible to access, mine, exploit, reproduce, and disseminate free of charge. And they also have to provide information about tools and instruments at the disposal of the beneficiaries and necessary for validating the result. Where possible, provide the tools and instruments themselves, IG, software, call, code, algorithm, analysis, protocols, etc. The approach is the following, as open as possible and as closed as necessary. The data management plan, the DMPs, are mandatory for all projects participating in the pilot and is optional for the others. DMPs are not part of the proposal evaluation. They have to be generated within the first 6 months of the project. It's possible to update them since DMPs are expected to mature during the project. The purpose of the DMP is to support the data management lifecycle for all data collected, processed, or generated by the project. The DMP questions are the following, and you can also see the EC template in the Annex 1 of our guideline. Everything is explained. In a few words, you have four main questions. The first one, what data will be collected, generated? What standards will be used? How will metadata be generated? What data will be exploited? What data will be shared, open? And how will data be curated and preserved? The DMP is a tool to determine what data sets can or cannot be open. So, which tool for this data management plan? We recommend to use the DMP Online, which is developed by DCC in the UK. This helps create a DMP based on the EC template. In the midterm view, so we have a EC DMP tool. I have no answer for the moment. It's under discussion, and it's very complicated to implement due to internal constraints. So for the moment, we recommend to use DMP Online. So what about the cost for data management? So these costs are eligible as part of Horizon 2020 research grants. There is no extra money assigned to them. You have the Article 6.2(d)(3) of the annotated model grant agreement, which refers to costs of other goods and services, which include dissemination costs, i.e. notably costs related to data maintenance or storage. So it's not written data management, but it's under this section, under this code. And there is no amount mentioned on this. As regards the first calls of Horizon 2020, and on the basis of the first signed grant agreements, we can see that 34.6% opt out of the project. In other words, if this means that 65.4% of projects in the core areas participate in the pilot. Concerning the areas that are not covered by the ballot, quite 12% opt in the pilot. So we have to be aware that 100% participation is not feasible or even desirable, given that not all projects generate data. So why they opt out? They opt out, the major reason is IPR protection. Not so So, am I late? Participating in the pilot is a chance to co-shape policy. Opening up research data is a new frontier after opening up scientific publication. It's an ambitious, yet there is a pragmatic design of the pilot to the extent the scope is broad, but you can opt out, you can voluntarily participate in, and you can also, when you are in the project, decide that certain data will remain closed. So it's really a flexible pilot. There are numerous safeguards in place, and the aim is to kickstart a virtuous circle. The uptake of and experiences with the pilot need to be monitored during the complete life cycle of the project, from application to grant preparation, execution, and final reporting. So once again, participation in this research data pilot means co-shaping European policy and opening up research data. So here are the resources if needed. So we have our guidelines, which are up to date. Also, this one with the list of data repositories, the list of open access journals, and also the link
for DCC and DMP online. Thank you.
We do have a few minutes for questions, and I see already one.
Hi, good morning. I'm Michael Strijs, legal SUB in the Netherlands. You mentioned that projects can opt out. My question is, can also single beneficiaries opt out? Next to that, projects can opt out, can also single beneficiaries opt out?
What do you mean by single beneficiaries?
Just one beneficiary, not the whole action, not all beneficiaries of a consortium, but one beneficiary which opts out while the rest is opting in.
I have no direct answer for you, but maybe the solution is to close the data, which will be problematic for this beneficiary, but I'm not sure that opting out from the project, it will be complicated if the other one are still in. So if the problem is linked with the data, maybe they can close this data, but not opt out from the project. The project is really flexible, so it has a choice between this solution, but I didn't hear this kind of situation, but I take it in account.
Other questions?
Yes, I also have a question about opting out. It says if participation in the pilot on open research data would jeopardize the achievement of the main aim of the action, what is meant by that?
It's really open because it depends on the project and on the data generated. There are so many fields that we had to think about a large possibility, but we can't synthesize in the guideline or in our policy what should this hypothesis be, because there are so many projects, so many fields, so many data that we can't think about the situation. That's why we have this kind of hypothesis. But in any way, the project will have to explain in the data management plan the reason. But for instance, we have no feedback about this. It's too early in the process.
And is there already some feedback on the financial side of it? Financing, storage, and long-term preservation? Because I guess most projects are not aware of the costs of this. In the first place, and try to find solutions now, and then they have to add more budget to it. So it might be a problem, or not, I don't know.
I understand you are not the first one to raise the question, but in our documents, we only have this article in the annotated grant agreement. And I'm looking for much more information, but I have no idea of the cost that will be generated. And it's too early to have feedback concerning this cost. So we have absolutely no idea of the amount. And once again, I think it will depend on the project, you know, on the fields, on the project, on the duration. There are several factors, I think, and it's really, really difficult. I have no idea about this, and there is no amount mentioned. So I'm sorry not to help you about this. Maybe the next time I will have answer for you, but now I'm sorry.
Hello, I'm Natalia Manola, and I'm from Open Air from the University of Athens. The question that I have is, you mentioned something about the data management plans and the mining. What kind of information do you hope to get out of mining? This is one question. And the other part, do you have criteria for the evaluation? Have you established the criteria for the evaluation?
So, So, for the first question. So we have the templates in our gathering. You see annex 1, annex 2. And there are many questions relating to the data you have to raise for the project. And concerning mining, the idea, as you know, and it's really important for research, is to enable researchers to do text and data mining on the research data, on the content. So it will push further the open access policies if TDM is allowed. And there is a discussion at the moment in the Commission about the copyright reform on this topic. And the idea for us in Horizon 2020 is really to enable researchers to do this, to perform this, to for the progress of science and so on. So it's really, really, really important for us that mining could be allowed. So the second, concerning the second question, we are not the first one. So, and we have not enough reported experience to draw conclusions about DMP. Currently, POs have many questions about how to deal with the first DMP they receive. They have many requests, and for the moment, we have no answer. I'm sorry. So, there is a current discussion in the European Commission at the moment. We have many questions. We reflect about the review of the DMP in the midterm or final review with experts in data management. And we also reflect on the... There is no evaluation of the first 6 months of DMP, because it's the first time we do this, and it's the first one. But I think PO for the moment deal with them, and they just take a look at it in the form and in the content, and that's it. So we reflect for a deep review, but not now, maybe later in the project. So it's in the front of this discussion.
This is the last question.
Why would there be a need of an EC DMP tool?
I'm sorry, what? Where do we stand in the process?
I mean, there's the ECC DMP tool, and then there was the bullet point that the ECC might need its own DMP tool.
It was indicated on the slide that your EC was thinking about DMP.
Yeah. Your question is about the EC DMP tool?
Why
not? Because, but we just raised a question internally, because it will be maybe easier for the project participating to have a central DMP tool, but I guess that for the moment, the one developed by DCC is really good for us. It helped create a DMP with our template, so it's under discussion, but we didn't take any definitive decision on it, so we just reflect.
Okay, thank you, Caroline. Caroline will be here during the break, so if you have more questions, you can ask her. But thank you again for explaining that.
Thank you.